Well, good morning, Sienna Ranch. Good to be with you all on this September the 11th. Come on, stand to your feet. We're going to worship our God. Can y'all hear that? I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. So I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. And I raise a hallelujah. Yeah. Comes to fight for me.
Here we go, y'all.
Come on, y'all, sing a little louder.
a hallelujah.
Good morning. So good to see everybody here this morning. If you're a visitor with you, I hope you got a little blue card. If you didn't, they're out there in the corner. And there's a white box at the back of the sanctuary that you can put it in. We want to keep track of you all.
That's right.
All right. I think I've covered all of that, but I do am so glad to see all of you here. There's a lot of places we could be this morning, but no better place.
Amen.
This is the house of the Lord. Amen. Let's welcome our precious Jesus to our service today. Father, you are our creator, our sustainer. You make the Christian life a joy. We can trust you. We can cry, Lord, when we just can't stand it anymore. And every time you meet us where we are. Father, I thank you this morning for salvation. It cost you a lot to buy that for us. You sent your son. Your son. To die on a cross. So that we can be forgiven. And then your Holy Spirit comes and lives in us and helps us. Lord, this world seems like it's fallen apart. It's probably seemed that way a few times before. But in this time and place, Lord, we need you every second. We love you, Lord. We thank you that we can gather here at Sienna Ranch this morning. We thank you for our wonderful pastor who leads us and all the other pastors that assist. You've been so good to us. And now, Lord, this day, this morning, at this time, please come and meet with us as we hear what Pastor has to say straight from you.
Yes, God.
In Jesus' name, amen.
In the midst of all that's going on, we can still see hope. We see an outcome that is glorious because our God's grace is sufficient. And no matter how many times we look at it, it comes up amazing.
Who breaks the power? Sin and darkness, who love is mine, and so much stronger, King of glory.
Yeah.
Okay. Come on, kids. Come on up. Have a seat on the floor down here. Face me. Hey, you too. Turn this way. All right. Okay. Well, I have a couple of manipulatives up here. We're gonna do a little game in a second. But I wanted to share with you guys out here. We started doing the Gospel Project at 9:15 today, and we're going to do it at 10:30 as well. So we have it for the Sunday School hour, and we also have it for the Children's Church hour. And it is amazing. It is such a wonderful, wonderful program for kids. And I'll send things home today with the kids from Children's Worship. So I'll send some things home to the parents. But the big picture question, we're learning about creation today and God's glory. And the big picture question is, why did God create everything? Why did God create everything? Okay. Anybody know? Ideas? Why did he create everything that you see? Why? For what? What do you think? For his purpose? For a purpose? Absolutely. For a purpose. So God created everything for his glory so that we can worship him. And that is a purpose. That's exactly right. So we're going to talk about worshiping real quick. All right. Twinnies, come on up. Has anyone ever said y'all look alike? No. Okay. So one of you will have a balloon. Are you good at blowing up balloons? Okay, go ahead. You can blow it up. The other one will have a straw. Okay, hang on to it. Don't let it blow out. Okay, that's good. All right, hang on to it. Yeah, don't tie it, okay? So you're going to have to bend down. I'm sorry, we're all wearing dresses. I didn't plan that very well, did I? But you're going to have to bend down, and you're going to use your balloon to blow this tennis ball, okay? So I'm going to put it right there. Y'all watch over here, and you're going to use that straw. I'm going to move you back a little tiny bit to blow this tennis ball, okay? So you kind of have to crouch down. Now, what I want you to do is get that tennis ball, let's say here, you know, or something to that effect, close to here. All right, on the count of three. One, two, three, go. Blow. Get close to it. Come on. You got to blow your balloon up again. Come on. Keep blowing. There you go. Keep blowing. All right, come on. Oh, maybe I'll make it here. All right, maybe I'll make it here. Oh, okay. Come on. Keep blowing that balloon. Come on. Oh, you're doing a good job here. Oh, okay, sisters, come on, oh my gosh, come on, here, come on, okay, all right, so here's the gist of the game. Thank you, girls. So, the idea is that when you blow up the balloon and you just do a poof, you know, and then it kind of stops, and then you just do a poof, and then it stops, is different than blowing through the straw, and it be a continual flow of air that pushes that tennis ball to the finish line, right? To the finish line, is how we worship. So if we're worshiping, guys, and we're just doing little spurts, we're just going like, oh, poof, I'm just going to worship a little bit, or oh, poof, I'm going to worship a little bit. That's not how God wants us to worship. God wants us to worship with a full giving, a full flow of air, a full body us. We want to consistently worship. If God created everything for his glory so that we could be a part of that and worship him, does that mean we just worship him on one little poof? No. It means we worship him with a continual flow of worship. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to go into children's worship. By the way, it's open to all K through 5th graders. You don't have to come if you're older and you're like, oh, I need to sit out here. And it's totally great because Mark's awesome. So if you are K through fifth grade and you want to come back to children's worship, let's go. Can you girls grab that? Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mandy. Thank you. Thank you, twins. I got it. I thought she was going to say, it's open to all of you as well, those that you would prefer to go out there, and all of a sudden everybody's gone. I also thought she was going to ask Oliver and myself to come up here and blow, you know, and so that would have been interesting for sure. Let's pray together. Eternal God and our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beginning of a new week. And just as we've been reminded, we can worship together corporately right now, but we have the opportunity all this week long to worship you. And as we see your creation and the goodness and the things that you're doing and the work all this week, I pray, Heavenly Father, that we will give you praise and honor and glory. And even our lives are made for your glory. I thank you, Father, that you are so good. And anything that happens, you redeem, and you restore, and you heal. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that as we gather together in your presence, you continue to do that. Take your word today, Lord, and may we hear from you. May we hear the words that you have for us. May your spirit, evidence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, speak to our heart today and bring these words to life in our lives. In your name we pray. Amen. I want to thank Bill so much for sharing with us the past couple of weeks. You know, what a joy and blessing that we have that have staff that are very gifted and can break open and rightly divide the Word of God. And so I thank Bill for these past couple of weeks, and it is a joy to be back with you today. We're back into Philippians, so we are going through the book of Philippians, and we will be beginning with verse 18, where we left off a couple of weeks ago in the first chapter of Philippians. In 1973, MGM released a film, a motion picture, that was entitled Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid. It was the story of the death of William Bonney, Billy the Kid. And the film had moderate success, but what stood out about it the most was one of the supporting cast members was the iconic musician Bob Dylan. And Dylan not only was a cowboy in this film, but they also asked him, one of the very first times, they asked him to write a song about a scene that would go in that film. The song is more famous than the film. Chris Christopherson, who played Billy the Kid in that film, a musician himself, said that Dylan's song was the strongest use of music he had ever seen in a movie. And it kind of brought into, now it's quite often that movies, part of them, there are music that is written specifically for it, or they're part of these scenes that are going on. But this is experimental kind of at the beginning when they did that. And so there is this one scene in the movie where Pat Garrett, who was a childhood friend of Billy the Kid, but now he's out to capture him, and he recruits a posse, a group of people, to go after Billy the Kid. And one of the people he recruits is a sheriff by the name of Colin Baker. And they locate Billy the Kid's gang, but he's not there. And so they say, tell us where he is. And the gang, of course, goes, over my dead body, we will tell you where he is. So a shootout takes place between them, and most of Billy's gang is killed in this shootout. But also Sheriff Baker is shot. And then very dramatically, as only Hollywood would do, you know, he's shot, he's here, and then he, for about 100 yards, he just walks, you know, just stumbling away, and then he comes, and I'm not going to do this, but then he kneels there, and his wife is also there. She's part of that posse, and she's been shooting away, and she sees her husband shot, and he calls her Mama. That's the name that he has for his wife, Mama. And then all of a sudden, with him there with this bullet, and his wife sees him, and she comes running after him, and he stops right by a river. Then the next scene is he dies. You have over that going back and forth between him and her in that, all you hear is the song that was written by Bob Dylan. Mama, take this badge off of me. I can't use it anymore. It's getting dark, too dark to see. I feel like I'm knocking on heaven's door. Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. That's where the scene ends there. It ends with the first verse, but in the soundtrack that came out afterwards, which won a Grammy because of Dylan's song, or at least was nominated for a Grammy because of Dylan's song, there's a second verse, and Dylan actually in concerts later has added additional verses, but the second verse, and you see it all relates to that one scene. Mama, put my guns on the ground. I can't shoot them anymore. That long black cloud is coming down, and I feel like I'm knocking on heaven's door. Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. And so the song that was written about one small scene in a relatively obscure motion picture became a worldwide hit. And even it's 49 years old now, and 150 different musicians over time have covered that song. People like Guns N' Roses and Eric Clapton and Bono and Paul Simon and many others. And so even though the movie in the origin behind that song is somewhat forgotten, it's a favorite among many and one of Dylan's most popular songs. Knocking on Heaven's Door has become a colloquialism, meaning that one is cognizant of one's impending death. It's the realization that I am dying. And it's a phrase that some people say, I've got one foot here on the ground and one foot in heaven. It might be when we're in hospice or realizing that death is imminent. And it's a phrase that that I think that epitomizes Paul as he writes this letter in Philippians. And he's going to communicate that to the church at Philippi. They've cared about him. They know the need that he is in. And so they've sent him a gift. And in his thank you note back to them, he is just responding and letting them know, being honest to them about his feelings and what is going on in his very life. He's very transparent in this passage. He's going to go before the emperor. And really what takes place is Christianity is on trial. Paul, the only crime against him is that he's a Christian. And he wants to know, will the Roman Empire say that, first of all, Christianity is a crime? And then secondly, what will be the punishment for that crime? There's the possibility that death will be the punishment for that crime. And so we're still a little bit early, a little bit later on. Christianity is declared illegal. And the punishment for Christianity in the Roman Empire is death. And you even find a governor by Pliny who writes the emperor, and he has these questions. Okay, I'm arresting them, but what have they done? And he said, "There's here I investigate them, and if I find out they're a Christian, I give them a chance, and you can recant. You can recant of your Christianity, and if you will bow down to these deities, you can go ahead and live." But any other crime, that's the only crime? But then any other crime, we don't allow them to recant and say, to bow down to a deities, and they're not punished for that. And so what are we supposed to do? And so it's the beginning of just seeing of how Christianity will be seen by the people in which they live. Is it an offense? Is it punishable by death? So Paul, his future is uncertain. He's waiting for that trial, and he could be found guilty, and he could be put to death. And ultimately, he will be. And I'll let you know, we believe now after this letter that he is released for a period of time, but there's a time that comes back and Paul will be executed. And so the theme of Philippians, we want to remember, is live life with the attitude of Christ. We are to live life with the attitude of Christ. And that we find that in Philippians 2, verse 5. Your attitude, Paul writes, should be the same as that of Jesus Christ. And we find that going all the way through this letter. And so here in this passage that we're going to look at this morning, he's given us that Christian attitude, that Christian perspective of life and death, how Christians look at life and death, and how it will be different than others look at life and death. So read with me from Philippians chapter 1, and I'm going to begin with verse 18. But what does it matter? And I'm going to come back and explain that in a minute here, because it's finishing off the last section that there is in. The important thing is that in every way, whether by false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, I will continue to rejoice. Do you notice that the verses in your versions, is it there in this translation, is there a division there? It's the same verse, but then all of a sudden there's a new paragraph. There might be, because Paul is transitioning from now the present, now I'm thinking about the future. I'm rejoicing in the present. He's rejoicing in the present because, as we looked at a couple of weeks ago, he saw that the gospel was advancing. That's why he's rejoicing. But there were people that were doing it from different motives. Some people were doing it from positive motives and good motives, and that was a good thing. But there are other people doing it out of bad motives, and they were vindictive towards Paul. And he goes, what does it matter? I don't care that they're out toward me. What is important is the gospel is advancing. That's how important the gospel was to him. And so, but then he says, yes, I will continue to rejoice. And so we're starting a new emphasis on there. He's going into it's in the middle of a verse. Numbers, remember, the numbers and the verses were put in far later than Paul's letter. We would never put divided up like that. Verse 19, for I know that through your prayers and the help given by the Holy Spirit, that what has happened to me, and remember that was in verse 12 and 2, what has happened to me? We talked about that. It's over an 11-year period of time from the time that Paul was arrested in Jerusalem, and now he has journeyed to Caesarea, and then he's gone to Rome, and he's gone through shipwrecks, and he's been beaten, and he's been bit by a snake, and all these things have happened. You know, he says, he brings that up again, you know, what has happened to me? Those difficult, those hard things that happened to him. What has happened to me, he says, will turn out for my deliverance. I eagerly expect and I hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but I will have sufficient courage so that now as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. And this is a verse I love. We'll camp out here a bit. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And if I am going on living in the body, that will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I don't know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is better by far. But it's more necessary for you that I remain in the body. And convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with you all for your progress and your joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your joy in Christ will overflow on account of me. And so, as we mentioned in 20, he begins with, what does it matter? Verse 18, I'm sorry. What does it matter? And, you know, but the important thing is the gospel is going forward, and he's talking about rejoice. And I can rejoice when people are against me, and I can rejoice also in times of uncertainty. I can rejoice in times of uncertainty about the things that I can be certain about. And so we see that God gives us certainty for times of uncertainty. You know, he doesn't know what the future holds. He doesn't know how the emperor is going to make the decision. That decision could mean his very death. And so I want you to see here that he begins this section, this passage that we read, and he bookends them with the same thing. If you look in verse 19, he says, for I know that through your prayers and the help given to me, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. He says, I know. There's a sense of confidence in there. He's going to what he knows. And he says, I know that I will be delivered. And then you look in verse 25 at the end of this passage. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain. And so Paul is contemplating his life and his death. You know, he's going into that taboo subject that a lot of times we don't like to talk about or think about. And he's considering, why am I here and what's this about and what happens after we die. He's thinking about these things out loud with the Philippians. And so he knows that my future is uncertain. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what's going to, as soon as that trial takes place, it could be any day. I don't know what's going to happen. So with uncertainty, Paul does not know if he's going to live or if he's going to die. And the truth is, none of us know that, do we? We never know how many days, years, months, or seconds we might have. Before I went to Senegal, I was going to a place I'd never been before, and at that time I was going with some people that I did not know before, and we were trying to find some people that we had never met before and didn't know anything about them. And so I wrote a letter to Marcia and Brian and Sarah, and fortunately they've never read it. But I wrote one to each of them, just expressing to them my love, just to reassure them of that very truth, but also expressing to them that I have no regrets, that this is what God has been led to do, and encouraging them to continue on with God and to trust Him. And as we're going to see here, and I am confident that we will be united once again in God's timing. Fortunately, like I said, that letter did not have to, but it was the going into the unknown, going into the uncertain. As a pastor, there's been times that I've sat with families in a waiting room where their loved one was about to go into surgery, and we did not know. You know, the doctor may have given incredibly poor odds of what, and there's been times when the doctors come out and move the family into a side conference room, and they've asked me to be in there, and I've been in there when that doctor informs them that their loved one has passed away. And so that's a part of life and what we deal with. And Paul is addressing that here of how we look at these things. And so there's this element of uncertainty in all of our lives all the time. Sometimes we are more aware of it than other times, but it's always there. But there's also certainty. And Paul is confident that he will be delivered, saved by God. And so it's interesting, this word delivered, it literally means saved. And the irony is, it can go both ways. He can be delivered by Caesar saying, Christianity is not a crime, and it's not punishable by death, and you are free. And you can go about your business. You can go about living however you so desire. And so Paul, it means going on and continuing his missionary work. Or could also mean his death. And Paul sees that as, I'm being delivered. I'm being delivered from this world and its pain and the brokenness of this. And now I am with Christ. So there's a double explanation that he says, and he's going to weigh that out before us. And let's look at that. In verse 19, he said, for I know that through your prayers that the help that was given by the Spirit of Christ, what has happened to turn out for my deliverance, what has happened to turn out for my salvation. And when he says that through your prayers, he's telling them that your prayers make a difference. They sent him a gift. They're hundreds of miles apart, away from Philippi and Rome, you know, nations apart. And yet he's saying the prayers that you pray make a difference in my life. And just as the gift that they gave to him of provision and supplies while he's there in jail, the prayers that the church is praying has helped him, especially. They were important in times of uncertainty. You know, a praying church prays for one another. And for Paul, he goes on in 19, you know, your prayers and the help that is given by the Spirit of Jesus Christ. And so he is aware that the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, and it's unique. He takes the Son and the Spirit and puts them together as God, the Spirit of Jesus Christ. It is there present with me, helping me. And it is the prayers of the people, knowing that they're praying for him, that has made him aware in the midst of the time that he is going through that God is there. And God is helping him. It was that reminder that he needed. In times of certainty, we can take our eyes off of God and forget that God is there and that he's working in the midst of that. But he is aware of the help of God and God's presence there. The Holy Spirit is the source of our security, especially in times of uncertainty. And the Holy Spirit is our very present help in times of trouble and difficulty. And so he is saying that it makes a difference, and God is at work, and God is with us. Look at verse 20. He says, I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed. And it's a different I'm embarrassed by this action. I'm embarrassed by what I have done. But I will have this sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether I live or whether I, by death. I eagerly expect and hope, he says. And so he is yielding to God's in his will and direction, and he's saying, I'm going to live by faith and hope through this. God is exalted. Now catch this here. God is exalted as he vindicates the faith of his people through deliverance. So God delivers us. God saves us. God rescues us in each and every situation. And that theme of God being vindicated, we being vindicated and God being exalted as we trust him in times of difficulty, as we trust him in times of uncertainty, that goes to exalt God. Let me just give you a couple examples. And Paul actually is drawing from two Old Testament passages right here. He's drawing first from Psalm chapter, the 25th Psalm. And it's a Psalm of David, a Psalm that King David is writing about. And the Psalm is phenomenal, and I would encourage you to read the whole thing this afternoon. I'm just going to read a couple of verses for you. But you remember, King Saul is after David. King Saul is out of the will of God, and he wants David dead. And David has the opportunity at a couple of different times to take Saul out, but he's not going to do anything against the Lord's anointed. And so he is going to trust God to see him through this entire thing. And as he goes through this, you know, we see that David will become king. He will be vindicated. You know, because of his patience, he wasn't guilty before Saul. Saul just had it out for him. God was against him. But God vindicates David by making him king. And as David becomes king, God is exalted. There's redemption in that. Listen to what he writes and sings in Psalm 25, verse 1. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. In you I trust, O my God. Do not let me be put to shame. Here's what Paul was coming from. Nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one whose hope is in you will ever be put to shame. But they will be put to shame who are treacherous without excuse. And so to put to shame for Paul was being out of the presence of God, away from God, not being around God, distance from God. He wanted to make sure that he was close to God through whatever happened. Paul also alludes to Job in this. And you remember Job was going through the most difficult of times. We believe Job was actually the first book of the Bible written. It was written before Genesis, or at least they're comparable the same time. That Genesis, that same time period that's going on. And Job is, he's lost everything. You know, his wife tells him, curse God and die. His friends say that it's due to your sin, and God's just judging you, and he wants you to turn back. And he said, I've honestly examined myself, and I don't see any sin that is there. In Job chapter 13, verse 13, we see Job interrupts his friends while they are giving him advice. And he says, keep silent and let me speak. And then let come to me what may. Why do I put myself in jeopardy and take my life into my hands? Though he slay me, he's talking about God. Though God slay me, yet I will hope in him. I will surely defend my ways to your face that I have not done wrong. I'm not being judged. I don't understand why this is going on and why God is allowing this to happen to me at this very time. But I know that it's not that I have offended God. Indeed, this will turn out for my deliverance. For no godless man would dare come before him. He comes before God and says, why? Why? But I'm going to trust you even though the time is uncertain and I do not know why. I am going to trust you and I believe that you will deliver me, that you will save me, that you will bring me through. Carefully listen to my words, verse 17, and let your ears take in what I say. Now that I have prepared my case, Job is saying this, I know that I will be vindicated. Paul's taken from Job. Paul's applying scripture from the Old Testament, you know, to his very life and saying that, and you see that all the way through scripture, when we come into those difficult times, that we come unto God and we trust that God, you will vindicate me, and as we are vindicated, God is exalted. And God is glorified. You know the best place we see that? We see it on the cross, right? So how does Peter preach at Pentecost? If you look at Acts chapter 2, when he's explaining, just why the Spirit of God has fallen on these followers of Christ. In verse 22, Peter, his message that he gives, men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man accredited by God to you by miracles and wonders and signs which he did among you, as you yourselves know. They were very well aware of what Jesus is. This man was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him on the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep hold of him. And so he is saying that Jesus Christ is the example of God the Father vindicating God the Son, and in the resurrection, God the Father, Son, and the Spirit are all glorified, right? They are all exalted, that God brings us through this. And then a little bit later in verse 36 of that same chapter, Paul says, therefore, let all of Israel be assured of this, that God made Jesus, whom you crucified, Lord and Christ. And so they looked at him and they said, you know, he's nothing. He's an imposter. He's a fool. But God vindicated Jesus through the resurrection, and he exalted him as Lord over all. So the Apostle Paul's on the road to Damascus, and he's persecuting Christians, and he desires to kill them. And all of a sudden, he's blinded and he hears a voice, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you, Lord? Why is Paul radically changed? He has seen that Jesus Christ has been vindicated by God and he has been exalted. God is exalted in that. And he says that I will live for Christ in the midst of my situation, knowing that as I live for him, my God will vindicate me. And as he vindicates me, he will be exalted and he will be glorified in this. And so we come to verse 21, the theme of the Christian life. If you want to sum up the Christian life, what it is, Paul says, for to me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. I love that. You know, different people have and I wrote in between Sundays about the different truisms people have or different mottos that people live by. But this is the one you should put on your refrigerator. This is the one that should be on your mirror each and every day. For me, to live is Christ, and to die, it's gain. He sums up the Christian life of the vindication and the exaltation. But do we do this? You know, when my son was playing baseball as a little kid, you know, the stores at that time, they probably still are, just not in that world anymore, right? But the stores had all these T-shirts, life is baseball, right? Life is football, life is soccer, life is whatever they are. Everything, you know, it's all these things. I didn't see one's life is Christ. I guess you had to go to Christian bookstore to get one of those, right? I did see a groomsman at his, not a groomsman, actually it was the groom, at his rehearsal dinner, a wedding I was doing, not here, so you don't have to worry, it wasn't any of your kids, but he wore to his rehearsal dinner a T-shirt, life is beer. So that tells you, you know, what was foremost important to him, not even life is my wife, or, you know, it's beer. And so, different. So how do you fill in that blank, though? What is, you know, life? Some life is family, you put it in with good things. Life is work. Life is money. Life is sex. Life is video games. You know, what is life to us? For the Christian, life is Christ. And when it's anything else, that's a god. That's a false god, that the reason that we are living for. This is life equals Christ. Just think about that. That's phenomenal to live over, to live is Christ means that my life is identified with Christ. I want my life in everything that I go through, and we're and our lives are not exempt from the things that Christ went through as well. I want to be identified through Christ in what I am going through, to live like him in every way all the time. And then he goes on to say, death is gain. Death is better. He says far better. Death is a plus. You know, Paul flips the conventional thought. The conventional thought that people would have would be life is gain. You know, if I can, if I'm sick and continue to live on, life is gain. God has given me additional time. And then death is Christ. That's kind of the conventional thought we have, but he has it, life is Christ and death is gain. Well, I'm not going to ask you, but how many of you want to go to heaven? You know, I would think here most people would raise their hands, yes. I won't have to put it, yeah, in there. And so they said, well, how many of you want to go to heaven today? We may not have everybody raise their hand right there, right? You know, and that's kind of the balance that we have here. And so, and Paul is going to weigh that out and then what that means for us. And so when we live for Christ, then to die is gain means to be with Christ in eternity. And that's far better than life here, the best of life here. Death is understood a lot of times as loss, right? And we say, I'm sorry for your loss. And definitely, you know, there's grief, there's loss, and there it is real. And Paul's not negating that at all. You know, and there's pain that goes on in any type of loss that we have, and grief that is immense. Vance Havner was a pastor and an evangelist of the previous generation, and he had a way with words. And one of the things he said when people criticized him for how long he spoke, they said, you know, your messages should be 15 minutes. And, I go to the Vance Havner school. No, but your message should be 15 minutes. And he said, well, sermonettes make Christianettes. What do you want to be? And so, but he also said on Sunday, September the 2nd, 1973, his wife, Sarah, passed away at 3:15 in the morning. At 11 a.m., he was in the pulpit. I would not be in the pulpit that day, but he was in the pulpit that day. And he said, some of you have said, I'm sorry for your loss. To loss means that you do not know where something is. I know exactly where Sarah is. And one day we will be united back together again. That didn't take away the grief. He wrote a whole book afterwards describing the emptiness, the loneliness, the two that had become one now was broken and apart, and that grief was real, and he wrote about that, but he knew that it was temporary, momentary grief as compared to eternal glory with Christ and God. He wrote this, death can hide, but not divide. She's but on the other side. She's with Christ, and Christ is with me. United still, in Christ are we. An interesting perception of just the part in the grief dealing with at that time. When life is money, to die is to lose it all. When life is work, to die is to be replaced. When life is to win, to die is to lose. When life is anything but Christ, to die is loss. But when life is Christ, to die is gain. Look at verse 22. If I am going on living in the body, this will mean more fruitful labor for me. Yet what I choose, I do not know. I am torn between the two. And so we see this great dilemma that he's going through. You know, I don't know whether it's better for me to, you know, which is more preferable. And really, it's not up to him. And he wasn't suicidal. That's not the aspect of it. But he's saying, you know, if you ask me what I'd rather do, I'd rather be in heaven, right? I would rather be in heaven. But you know, that's not a choice. So what is it going to be? So there's this great dilemma that Paul is going through where he contemplates life in Christ here versus life with Christ in heaven. And if I'm going on living for the body, that will mean fruitful labor for me. It's work that is productive. It is work that bears fruit. It is work that is good. It is work that, you know, gives honor and glory to God. And it doesn't have to be a job, right? It means that the things that I do to the day that I die are going to be fruitful. And it's going to be good. And it's going to honor and glorify God. I'm going to live for Christ each and every day. He's committed to living that redemptive life. Verse 23, I am torn between the two. I desire to part and be with Christ, which is better. And so he concludes knowing that heaven is far better. You know, I can't imagine what life is like to be a royal. I don't have any desire to be a royal. But I would think that Queen Elizabeth found out that she was living in the slums compared to where she is in Christ, right? No comparison at all. We do not know. I believe, you know, eternity is a lot like here. It's earth. We work. We do things. But there's no sin. There's no brokenness. And it's productive. And I think even the things that we're going, this was here all the time. And everything, we just, wow, we glorify God all the more. All the more. Verse 24, but it is more necessary that I remain in the body. So Paul's going to conclude that, you know, really I need to stay here. Now we say, yeah, sure, Paul, you just, you know, you really don't want to die right now. And so you're just, but look at the motive that he gives for this. It's a demonstration of the attitude of Christ, right? This theme is about the attitude of Christ. So what is his motive? I just want to live longer, or there's still something for me to do. But he says that, if you look at 24, it is more necessary for you that I remain. He's putting others before self. He said, I'm putting others before self. And that's why God wants me here, because others are going to be put before myself. And when I come back to Philippi and you celebrate and you see that God has redeemed this and God has brought this out, it brings incredible joy, and it gives us confidence to the unknown all the time, and it gives us confidence in death. You know, when we see someone that you know, it's miraculous, right? It's miraculous. A healing takes place, and it's miraculous. I think that's beautiful, that's wonderful, that it's exalting God, but it's also a message. It's also a message that when we do die, or when death comes into our family, that God is also exalted in the same way. He's using what we know to show us what we do not know, so we can have that hope in him in those times of uncertainty. And so for Paul, to live as Christ here is to put others before self. 25, convinced of this, I know that I will remain and I will continue to be with you in your progress in the joy of the faith, so that through my being with you again, your joy in Christ will overflow on account of me. When he arrives there, they will celebrate what God has done. To live for Christ here is to advance the gospel. That's what he said earlier, right? I live that more and more people would know this relationship with him. It is to see the glory of God displayed day to day on this earth. I don't know that when we come to heaven that we knock on heaven's door, right? What I see from Scripture is that Jesus is knocking on our door. He said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and anybody who opens the door to me, I will come into him and eat with him." And there's that fellowship that we have with him. And then in John, he talks about, "I am the door." And so the door is open, right? And he asks us to go through. So it's not a matter of getting up there and knocking and seeing, but it's knowing and living with him right now. He is the Christ. He is the door. And so to live is Christ, to die is gain. And we see that to live Christ here, you know, it's the ultimate win-win, right? It's the ultimate win-win. That he delivers us, he saves us in there. You know, there's a painting down the hall that I donated, and I will take it one day. It's a painting that I purchased. And so in 2018, I guess, we moved my mom back here, and many of you know this story, but her cancer came back, and we moved my mom back. And at the late part of 2018, maybe, after her second bout in treatments of cancer, the determination was made by her and us that we would no longer go through treatments, and she was placed on hospice. And amazingly, she lived another year. You know, and for most of that year, she lived very well and good. It was just in the last that the cancer just picked up and picked up. But and my mom was remarkable through that process. But as I'm dealing with that, you know, I'm knocking on heaven's door. That I have 1 foot here on earth, and you know, I'm seeing her go through this, and I'm knowing that any day, like the day that we did, where we opened up the door and she passed away in her sleep, you know, any day that could happen. And so in the process, you know, a friend of mine, Jamie Wells, I was looking at the paintings that she had painted, and this one is entitled "We Shall Rise Forever," and it just the title hit me first. "We Shall Rise Forever," and I asked Jamie what was the meaning of it. It wasn't what I, you know. She said, "Well, we were here in Houston during Harvey, and then we moved to California, and all the wildfires came in, and we had to evacuate out there. So it was just, and it was a matter of in both places, I just saw people rising together." And so as y'all corrected me, I was going, "Oh, it's the sunrise, you know? And so the sunrise, as the sun rises every day, you know, how God uses creation to show, you know, the hope in that." And James said, "Well, it's a sunset, you know?" And then I realized every time there's a sunset, there's a sunrise. Why is that? Because God is faithful. And he shows that to us every time. In creation, the days are built that way. So whatever we are going through in the darkness of that moment at that very time, that sunrise that comes. So I bought that painting. You know, I because it just meant so much. And it helped me so much through that very time to show that God is a God who delivers. And God is a God that is faithful. And God is a God through what we are going through that we can trust. And to every moment that he gives to us, live for Christ and die, and death is gain. Would you bow your heads with me? What do you live for? In your own heart, before God, how would you answer that question? Can you honestly say, "I live for Christ"? And if you can't, what is he saying that you need to do to make that live for Christ? there's some things that have become more important. And you do realize that when we live for Christ, you know, family and marriage and work and all those things become far more richer, far better, far fulfilling, far more productive, because they're no longer gods, but they are things that God made good, and they're lived in the way that they should. I'd encourage you this week to just to reflect upon what it means to live for Christ each day. I want you to know that God is a God of hope. And that's what Paul was based on. He had met the resurrected Christ after he was trying to eliminate his followers. And when life is Christ, he saw that because Christ is vindicated and God is exalted, then when life is Christ, we are vindicated because of the faithfulness of God. And God is exalted through that as well. So take courage. Move forward. Continue on. And allow God to work and to heal and to be glorified. Father, I thank you so much for this church family. You love this group so much. If I would say that somebody's hurting today, someone may think I'm talking about them, and we know there are so many in this room today that are hurting. So many that there's uncertainties. So many that it's hard. And life is painful in so many different ways. But you are faithful. And you are good. And you're present. And you're with us. And you will see us through. May we continue to trust and follow and walk with you. May Christ be our life. In your name we pray. Amen. Bill will come. We'll share our announcements.
Thank you, Mark. I got a couple of announcements before we leave this morning. First of all, thank you so much for those of you that are visiting with us. There's a blue card that you should have gotten this morning. And again, if you have some time, if you haven't yet done so, be sure to fill this out. There's a white box on the back that you can place that in the box. We just love to know that you visited with us this morning. Also, Sundays at 9:15 a.m., I think Mandy mentioned this earlier, we have Bible studies going on for 2 years old through 12th grade. They're not all in one room together. But they have a number of different classes going on that we started this Sunday. And also there's an Experiencing God class that started this Sunday morning as well, that you can jump in and join that if you weren't here this morning. So 9:15, we have Bible study for all ages, and we also have two other Bible study groups that meet at 9:15. Mark Choate leads a group, and then Quentin Fogelman is leading a group also on Sunday morning. Next Sunday is going to be epic. Okay, so we have next Sunday at 6 p.m. Dr. Louis Marcos is going to come share with us about the abolition of man. So I say this every time he comes. If you have not yet heard Dr. Louis Marcos speak, you are missing out. He's an electric, very energetic, very thoughtful speaker. And so even if you've never read Abolition of Man, you'll want to read it after he speaks on Sunday night. So just come join us next Sunday at 6 p.m. To hear Dr. Louis Marcos talk about that. And then the last thing I want to mention is that something else that will be epic that is going on is we have our children's Christmas musical about to happen. It will be epic. So rehearsals start October 12th. I think they've got some contract negotiations going on until then. So, but they got October 12th is going to be they're going to start rehearsing that for that on Wednesday nights. Stephanie Northcutt is leading that for us. And the last thing, just thank you so much for giving. And those of you that are watching this morning, if you want to give, you can give to online at siennaranch.org/giving. You can do that as well. Or if you'd like to write a check, you can put an offering, put the offering in the white box in the back. But thank you so much for giving, and hope you guys have a great week.
Come on, stand to your feet. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased by God, born of His Spirit. Song, praising my soul.